Open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14, and I want to bring something to your attention right at the outset that is very logical. Very what, everyone? Logical. Now, we've made this point before, but I want to make it again. Revelation chapter 14, and in Revelation chapter 14, we find the most serious warning in all of the Bible. In Revelation chapter 14, we find the most serious warning in all of the Bible, and it has to do with the issue of the mark of the beast. So let's look at that. Revelation chapter 14, and I'm reading in verse 9. What verse, everyone? 9. Then a third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone, what's the next word? Worships the beast in his image, or receives his mark on his forehead or in his hand, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who what? Worship the beast in his image, and whoever receives what? The mark of his name. You cannot find a more serious, more austere, more amazing, I don't know how to say it, significant, serious warning in all of the Bible than that one right there. Okay, now I want you to think about this for just a moment. God's basically saying, don't get the mark of the beast. 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 Now, is it reasonable of God for him to tell us, don't get the mark of the beast, and then not make it clear as to what the mark of the beast is? Does that make sense? It would be a little bit like God saying, don't touch the snickerdoodle. Don't touch the snickerdoodle. Don't touch the snickerdoodle. And we say, God, what is the snickerdoodle? And he says, well, that's for me to know and you to find out. Does that make any sense, everyone? No sense whatsoever. And so tonight we're going to proceed in a very logical, very linear fashion, and we're going to ask ourselves from the Bible, what is this question, this idea of the mark of the beast? And we're going to start right in our study guide. We're beginning in the first little paragraph there. The mark of the beast is one of the most serious and misunderstood subjects in the Bible. Since we have already identified the beast of Revelation chapter 13, we need only to discover what his what? Mark is. After all, the mark of the beast is just that, the mark of the beast. That is, it's the beast's what? Mark. Once the beast has been biblically identified, the matter of uncovering his mark becomes almost elementary, as we shall see. Sometimes we say the word mark of the beast as though it's one word. You don't want to get the mark of the beast. Right? We say, the mark of the beast. But let's slow down, if that's possible for me, and let's really discuss what is the mark of the what? The beast. So then that tells me that the mark of the beast would be the mark of the beast. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. So instead of trying to figure out what's the mark of the beast, right, whatever that might be, we say it all like it's one word, let's figure out who the beast is, and then it's elementary for us to say what's his mark. Because the mark of the beast would be the mark of the beast. If that makes sense, say amen. Okay, so far so good. So don't forget the issue. We're right there in your study guide. As we study the topic of the mark of the beast, we must bear in mind what we have learned from our past studies in Revelation. First, we have learned that there is a great conflict. A great what, everyone? Conflict. A great conflict that surrounds God, his character, his law, and his government. Satan has claimed that God is unfair, unjust, and self-serving. Satan has claimed that he could run the universe essentially better than God. This backdrop of the larger issue at stake, namely God's own character, helps us to understand with clarity the big picture issues in Revelation. Second, the central issue at the worship at the end of time, according to the book of Revelation, is the issue of, you say it with me, worship. Keeping these two Revelation essentials in mind will be exceedingly helpful in understanding the mark of the beast issue. Let us go to the screen. The mark of the beast is, let's say it together, the mark of the beast. Okay, let's try it again. The mark of the beast is the mark of the beast. If that makes sense, say amen. So the first beast of Revelation chapter 13, we've already identified as the Roman church state. We've already identified, we know who the beast is, we know who the Antichrist is, and so what we're looking for tonight is the mark of the beast. Are we all together on that, everyone? If we know who the beast is, we just have to figure out what his mark is, okay? Now, the second beast of Revelation chapter 13 is the spokesman for the first beast, sometimes referred to as the false prophet. How many of you have heard that term before? The false prophet, okay, you find that in Revelation. We'll be talking about the false prophet tomorrow night, okay? Now, the Bible predicts there will be an erosion of freedom when church and state unite. The Bible predicts that there will be an erosion of civil liberties when church and state, what's the next word, everyone? Unite. In fact, let me just show you that very quickly. You're still in Revelation there. Look at Revelation chapter 13. I want to show you one of the most important words in Revelation chapter 13. Revelation chapter 13, and I'm looking at verse 12. What verse, everyone? It says, he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence, and, what's the next word? Causes the earth and those who dwell in it to what? Worship. So let me summarize. He causes the earth to worship in a certain way. Okay? Cause means to force. Cause means what? To force. Now jump down to verse 15. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and what? Cause as many as would not what? Worship the image of the beast should be killed. And look at verse 16. He what? Causes. And so the idea here is that people are being forced to worship in a certain way. If that makes sense, say amen. It comes up several times here in Revelation 13. Causes, 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 and the word means being forced. Being what, everyone? Forced. Now think of it this way. Does God ever force us to worship him in a certain way, yes or no? Absolutely not. God says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest, right? The Bible also says in Jeremiah chapter 33, the Lord has appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Listen carefully. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn thee. I have what, everyone? Drawn thee. So God says, come to me. I want to draw you. I want to woo you. That's the God of the Bible. But the beast says, worship or else. If that makes sense, say amen. And so that's really the mark of the beast, is this idea of the enforcement of worship, the enforcement of certain religious values. And that's why we say the Bible predicts an erosion of freedom. What is the mark of the beast? Well, as we've already discussed, it's the mark of the beast. There we go. And what is this mysterious number, 666? You're still there in Revelation chapter 13. Let's take a look at that. Revelation chapter 13. And it says there right toward the end of it, verse 16, he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a what? A mark on their right hand or in their forehead, so that no one might buy or sell. So there's economic sanctions involved, except the one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number or the what, everyone? The number of his name, here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is what? 666. And tomorrow night, I'm going to tell you exactly what 666 is. I'll show you exactly what 666 is. I wish we could do it tonight, but we just have time to cover the mark of the beast. But these two ideas are intertwined. They're what, everyone? Intertwined. And so tonight we're going to answer the question and ask the question, what is the mark of the beast? And there are many different ideas out there. And some of them, frankly, are rubbish. I mean, they're just ideas that someone got. They've heard about a computer in Switzerland, and it's called the Beast, and it prints out little tags, and et cetera, et cetera. All of these things, people have different ideas and different conjectures, which is not based on the guess what? The Bible. Some people say, oh, I've heard the mark of the beast is a government identification number that's going to be tattooed on your right hand or on your forehead. Some say the mark of the beast is a barcode of some kind. It's those UPC symbols in the Kroger store, so watch out. Others say the mark of the beast is a number on a credit card. You better be very careful that you don't have 666 there. But we have seen that the central issue regarding the mark of the beast is not about computer chips and tattoos. It's the issue of worship. The issue of what, everyone? Worship. And not just worship, but forced worship. You will worship in this certain way or else. He causes, he causes, he causes. If this makes sense so far, say amen. See, beloved, think of it this way. God is not going to say in Revelation over and over again, the issue is worship, the issue is worship, the issue is worship, the issue is worship. And then we get down to the end of the time, and it's about a computer in Switzerland. Does that make any sense to anyone? It doesn't make one wink of sense. What we need to do, instead of reading the fantastic, sensational websites and, you know, outlets and Christian magazines, far better to go to what the Bible says and see what the Bible says about the mark of the beast issue. If that makes sense, say amen. Powerful. Okay, so now we're back to our study guide. God's seal versus the mark of the beast. God's seal versus the mark of the beast. Our message tonight is entitled, How Not to Get the Mark of the Beast. I mean, who cares if you know what it is? This is how not to get it. Amen? That's like saying, would you rather know what the flu is in a scientific way, or would you rather know how not to get it? I'd rather know how not to get it. Does that make sense, everyone? So let's talk about how not to get it. God's seal versus the mark of the beast. In order to understand the mark of the beast, we must first understand what? God's seal. These two are the opposite of one another. If you have one, you cannot have the other. They're like oil and water. The issue then for the believer should be about ensuring that he or she does have, what are the next two words? The seal of God. That's right. In short, the seal of God should be the primary focus, not what, everyone? The mark of the beast. In obtaining the seal, one is guaranteed that he, she cannot also receive the mark of the beast. So let us first seek to understand the seal of God. If that makes sense, I want you to say amen. Think of it this way. If you have the seal of God, by definition, you don't have the mark of the beast. Does that make sense, everyone? And so, since these two things are polar opposites and mutually exclusive, instead of wondering, oh, I wonder what the mark of the beast is. I hope I don't get it. And there's a whole other group of people who say, oh, don't worry about it at all. You're going to be raptured anyway. Beloved, think of it this way. Instead of worrying about what the mark of the beast is, let's say, what do we have to do in order to ensure that we could never get it? Does that make sense? So now it's not just an intellectual exercise, curiosity. I wonder what it is. I wonder what it could be. No, now we're saying, how do we ensure that we don't end up with it, whatever it is? Does that make sense, everyone? Yes or no? And so the answer is you get the seal of God. Because if you have the seal of God, you can't have the guess what? The mark of the beast. So it's more important for us to understand that than the mark of the beast. And actually what we're going to discover is once we've got the seal of God signed, sealed, and delivered, then the mark of the beast becomes almost elementary. Okay, so let's continue on here. Bottom of the page there, the seal and the 144,000. Open your Bibles to Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. You're still there in Revelation, so let's do that. Revelation chapter 7. I'm reading in my study guide here. The 144,000 spoken of in Revelation chapter 7, verses 1 to 4 and 14, 1 to 5, all have the seal of God where? In their forehead. Let's take a look at that. Revelation chapter 7, beginning in verse 1. After these things, I saw the four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, on the sea, nor on any tree. Then I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the what? Seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees till we have what? Sealed the who? Servants of God where? On their forehead. And I heard the number of those that were sealed, and the number was 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. And so those that are sealed where? In their foreheads. Now, let's remember something here that's absolutely critical. You can get the mark of the beast in one of two places. You could get the mark where? On your right hand, or where? In your forehead. But you can only get the seal where? In the forehead. That'll become critical in just a moment. Now, let's continue in our study guide. We're on the second page. Note that the mark of the beast can be received either in the, you'd write that down, the hand or in the forehead. But the seal of God can be received only in the forehead. Now, according to Revelation chapter 6, verses 12 to 17, let's look at those verses. Revelation chapter 6. Some people say, who are the 144,000? I've heard that the 144,000 are a group of super Jews at the end of time who go out to convert all of the people who were left behind at the rapture. Well, that's very imaginative and that's, you know, very creative, but I want to know what the Bible says, not just what people think is creative. Can you say amen? So let's see what the Bible says about the 144,000. I'm in Revelation chapter 6 and I'm looking in verse 12. Revelation chapter 6 and what verse, everyone? 12. This is the opening of the sixth seal off of that scroll. John says, I looked and he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great, what, everyone? Earthquake. The sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. Wow, this must be an amazing event. The mountains are disappearing, the islands are disappearing, verse 15, and the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man, hid themselves in the what? Caves and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the rocks and mountains, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the what? Wrath of the Lamb. Remember we talked about that last night? It doesn't say the wrath of the lion. It doesn't say the wrath of the grizzly bear. It says the wrath of the what? Lamb. Now look at verse 17. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who is able to stand? So this is clearly depicting the second coming of Jesus. I mean, the mountains are disappearing, the islands are disappearing, and here comes Jesus, the wrath of the Lamb, right? And as he's returning to come and take his promised precious people home, people are looking up, and those that are not saved, those who have not put their faith in Jesus, are running to the rocks and saying, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne." Now notice how it ends there, verse 17. It ends with a question. It ends with a what, everyone? The question is this: the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to what? Stand. So look at Revelation chapter 6 ends with a question. Who will be able to endure this catastrophic, cataclysmic, amazing event of the second coming of Jesus? And then the answer is Revelation chapter 7. The 144,000. If that makes sense, say amen. See, remember that the chapters and verses in your Bibles were added. That would have been read before the chapters, the versification, and the various chapters added. That would have just read, "Who is able to stand? After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind and sea should not blow on the earth or on any sea. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, 'Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees, till we have sealed the what? Servants of God,' where? In their foreheads." So the 144,000 are those who are alive when Jesus returns. The 144,000 is not a group of super Jews at the end of time that go out to evangelize. I don't know where people got that idea, but you didn't get it from the Bible. These are those people who are alive when Jesus returns. John asked the question, the great day of his wrath has come, who can stand? And then he says, the 144,000. Now look back at your study guide. This is absolutely powerful. It says, the 144,000 are those who are alive when Jesus Christ returns to the earth. They sing a song that no one else can sing because they pass through an experience that no other generation has known. The number does not have to be a literal number, as everything in Revelation is highly symbolic, and the number itself is quite obviously steeped in theological significance. And by the way, I don't make a big deal out of that either way. It may be a literal number, and it may not be a literal number. It's just one of those things that we'll find out when we get to heaven. Someone say amen. There are just certain things that you're not going to know. That is not a hill worth dying on. If you think it's a literal number, hey, knock yourselves out. Good for you. If I think it's a symbolic number, hey, that's fine. Not one of us in this room knows for certain if it's literal or symbolic, but whether it's literal or symbolic, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in. Can you say amen? Okay, so don't get in fights over these little non-issues. The 144,000 are undefiled by women, that is, false churches. They have God's seal in their foreheads, that is, in their hearts and in their beliefs. Now let's think about that for just a moment. They are sealed with, look at this again, it says they are sealed in their foreheads. Now go to Revelation chapter 14. This is the other place that we see the 144,000. Revelation what chapter, everyone? Revelation chapter 14, and I'm reading in verse 1. Revelation chapter 14, and I'm in verse what, everyone? 1. John says, "Then I looked and behold a what? Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000. Now watch this. Having his father's what? Name written where? Oh, wow, what a discovery. What a discovery. We just learned in Revelation chapter 7 that they have the seal of God in their foreheads, and here we learn that they have the name of God in their foreheads, which must mean that the seal is the name of God. If that makes sense, say amen. Pretty plain. Look at the rest of the verse. Verse 2, "And I heard a voice from heaven like the voice of many waters and like the voice of a loud thunder. And I heard the harps, sound of harpists harping on their harps." I like that so much. Verse 3, "They sang as it were a new song before the throne, before the four living creatures and the elders. And no one could learn that song except the 144,000. Look at this. Who were redeemed from the earth." Hey, that agrees perfectly with what we just saw in Revelation chapter 6 and 7. These are those who are alive when Jesus returns. If that makes sense, say amen. Why can they sing a new song that no one else can sing? Because they've passed through an experience that no one else has passed through. Maybe you've heard of the people that would sing the blues, and a white guy would come along and try to sing the blues, and they say, "He can't sing the blues." Well, why can't he sing the blues? Because he's not been through the experience of those who first wrote the blues. If that makes sense, say amen. In other words, these people can sing a song that no one else can sing because they have passed through an experience that no one else has passed through. If that makes sense, say amen. But it gets even better. Verse 4, "These are the ones who are not defiled with women." A woman in Bible prophecy is a church. for they are virgins. These are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits to God and to the Lamb, and in their mouth was found no what? Deceit, for they are without fault before the throne of God. So here are these 144,000 at the end of time, those who are alive when Jesus returns. And notice that it says they have the seal of God in their forehead. That's Revelation chapter 7. Then in Revelation 14, it says they have what in their forehead? The name of God. So the seal must have to do with the guess what? The name of God. Okay, now let's go to our study guide here. God's name, God's character, and God's law. God's name, God's character, and God's law. In the Bible, name represents character. That's what you'd write down. In the Bible, name represents character. This is demonstrated by the number of people who, following a transformative encounter with God, had their name changed as a symbol of the larger character change. For example, Saul became what?
Paul.
You've got it. Jacob became Israel. Abram became Abraham. Sarai became Sarah. And Simon became Peter. You've got it. God's holy character and holy name are synonymous with his law. Now, I want to show you this. Go to Exodus chapter 33. This is absolutely profoundly amazing. We're going to Exodus chapter 33, second book of the Bible. Exodus chapter 33. What chapter are we going to, everyone? Exodus chapter 33. And here we find Moses in a dialogue with God atop Mount Sinai's summit. So here's God, here's Moses, and they're in a conversation. They're in a what, everyone? Conversation. I'm picking it up in verse 18. Moses speaking to God, Exodus 33, verse 18. And he said, "Please show me your what? Your glory." See, there's Moses standing on top of Mount Sinai, and there were thick clouds, and there were lightnings, and there were thunderings. And Moses began to realize, hey, God can see me, but I can't see what? God. And so he says, hey, I beg of you, show me your glory. In other words, show me what you're like. I want to see you. And look at this, verse 19. Then he said, I will make all my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim the what? The name of the Lord. Now make a note of that. Moses says, I want to see what you're like. And God says, I'll show you my name. I'll show you my what? The name of the Lord before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. I will have compassion to whom I will have compassion. But he said, you cannot see my face, for no man shall see my face and what? Live. And the Lord said, here is a place by me. You shall stand on the rock. So it shall be while my glory passes by that I will put you in the cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand while I pass by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. Chapter 34, verse 1. And the Lord said to Moses, cut two tablets of what? Stone, like the first ones, and I will write on these tablets the words which were on the first tablets which you broke. So be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai, and present yourself to me there on the top of the mountain, and no man shall come up with you, and let no man be seen throughout all the mountain, neither let the flocks nor the herds feed before that mountain. So he cut two tables of what, everyone? Stone, like the first ones. Then Moses rose up early in the morning and went up Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him. And he took in his hand two tablets of what, everyone? Stone. Now the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there. Now watch this. And proclaimed the what? The name of the Lord. So two times Moses says, hey, I want to know what you look like. I want to see what you're like, God. And God says, I'll show you my name. And then he says, go get two tablets of stone. I want to write my law on that. And I'm going to show you my name. If this makes sense, say amen. And then watch what happens. Verse 6, and the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, Jehovah, Jehovah, the Lord, God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy in thousands, forgiving iniquity, transgression, and sin, and by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children under the third and fourth generation. So Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth, and he did what? He worshiped. Now think about this for just a moment. Moses says, I want to know what you're like. I want to see your glory. I want to see your character. And God says two things. I'll show you my name. I'll show you my name. I'll show you my what? My name. So that must mean that God's name is synonymous with his character. If that makes sense, say amen. And it gets even better. He says, go get me two tablets of stone. And so God wrote his character, his holy character, on those tablets of stone with his own what? Finger, and then those tablets were taken and placed where? In the ark. And so now look at your study guide. God's holy character and name are synonymous with his law. God's seal, which is his name and character, are found to be synonymous with his name. Whoo, we're getting somewhere now, aren't we? The 144,000 were sealed in their foreheads. And then we found out that they had the name of God in their foreheads. They had the what of God in their foreheads? The name of God. Well, what's the name of God? It's his character. And where do we find his character? In his law. Now, you're still there in the Old Testament. Go to Deuteronomy chapter 5. Deuteronomy chapter 5. What chapter, everyone? 5, fifth book of the Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 5. By the way, are you noticing tonight that we're spending a lot of time in the Bible? Are you noticing that? Is everyone noticing that? Yes or no? So notice we didn't say, what's the mark of the beast? And I didn't go, choo, 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 choo. Look at all these pictures of computers in Belgium. No, 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 beloved. We're taking a look at what the Bible has to say. Amen? Wouldn't you prefer that? Look at Deuteronomy chapter 5. We find here the Ten Commandments. Deuteronomy chapter 5. Do you see that, everyone? Look at verse 5. I stood between the Lord and you at that time to declare to you the word of the Lord. For you were afraid because of the fire, and you did not go up to the mountain. And he said, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Let's say it together. You shall have no other gods before me. First commandment, no other gods. Don't render worship to any other gods. Second commandment, you shall not make for yourself a carved image. A what kind of image? Don't bow down or worship any images. Look at the third commandment. It's in verse 11. You shall not take the what? The name of the Lord your God in vain. And look at the fourth commandment, verse 12. Observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy as the Lord your God commanded you. Absolutely amazing. First commandment, no other gods. Second commandment, don't bow down to graven images or idols. Third commandment, don't take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Fourth commandment, remember God's Sabbath because it's a sign of his creation and his redemption. If this all makes sense, say amen. Now this is Deuteronomy chapter what? 5. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. Very next chapter. Very next chapter. Where did they get this idea of a mark in the head or a mark in the hand? I'll show you right here in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And I'm beginning in verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 6. And these words which I command you today shall be in your what? Heart. What words? What words in context is he talking about? The Ten Commandments. That's what he just had in Deuteronomy chapter 5. And so in Deuteronomy chapter 6, he says, these words need to be where? In your heart. Look at verse 7. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Now watch verse 8. Phenomenal. You shall bind them as a, what is that word? A sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your what? Eyes. Isn't this interesting? He says, take my law and put it on your hand. Take my law and put it between your eyes. What's between your eyes? Your forehead is between your eyes. Can someone say amen? Amen. So, where is this old idea of the seal in the forehead coming from? Straight out of the Old Testament. Can someone say amen? See, we've all been worried about a tattoo that someone is going to hold us down and tattoo the number 666 across our forehead. Beloved, beloved, you think the devil's that stupid? This is not about a tattoo or a computer chip or some supercomputer in Belgium or any other country. The issue is worship, not technology. If that makes sense, say amen. And here God says, hey, listen, I need you to take my law and bind it on your hands. Now, what did that mean? It meant in your daily works. Let your works show that you are my children. Can you say amen? Let your hands, what does it say there? We already read it in Ecclesiastes chapter 9. I'll just quote it for you. The Solomon says, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. Okay, so your hands, you put my law into your hands. May your works show that you are my people. May your works show that I am your God. Bind my law in your hands. But don't just bind it in your hands. Put it as frontlets. Those were the little horns that like a lamb would have. Put it as a frontlet between your eyes. In other words, put it in your forehead. Put it in your mind. Don't just live the life with your hands, but think the thoughts in your heart and in your mind. Someone say amen. That's what it means to be a Christian. Is that true or not? It means to be a Christian is to have the law of God, the Spirit of God in our minds and in our hands so that others could look and say there's something different about him. There's something different about her. What is it? She or he is a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can someone say amen? Powerful. So the name of God is the same as the law of God is the seal of God. And when we find this idea of the seal of God being in the foreheads, where did they come up with that idea? Right out of Deuteronomy chapter 6. Take these great things, law. Those people who receive God's seal at the end of time will be those who honor and keep God's holy what? Law. This is exactly how Revelation describes them in Revelation chapter, let's go on, 12. Go with me to Revelation. Look at this. This is so easy to understand. Anyone in this room can understand this. Even if you don't understand all of the language and you can't keep up and you don't know even how to find the book of Revelation in your Bible, I guarantee you can understand this next point I'm about ready to make. And if you understand that point, you can be guaranteed to not get the mark of the beast. I'm in Revelation chapter 12. Revelation what chapter? 12, and I'm looking at the last verse. The last verse. Verse 17, it says, and the dragon, who's the dragon? The devil was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. This is the last day church, beloved. These are the last of the last of the last. The Bible calls them the remnant. Calls them the what? The remnant. And notice it says that they keep God's commandments. Can you say amen? The devil apparently doesn't like that very much. Now look at Revelation chapter 14. Now we've already read in Revelation chapter 14 that most serious, austere warning found in all of the Bible. Right? We began in verse 9 and we read, don't worship the beast, don't receive his mark. Then we read in verse 10, he himself shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. I'm in Revelation 14, verse 10, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. Verse 11, and the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast in his image, and whoever receives the mark of his name. So John in vision sees this group of people that are receiving the mark of the beast. They're receiving the what, everyone? The mark of the beast. And the very next verse, verse 12, look at it. It's as if God is saying, here's those that receive the mark of the beast, but look at verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. The word literally is here is the endurance of the saints. And then he tells us who the saints are. He gives us two characteristics. Here are those who keep the what? The commandments of God and have the what? Faith of Jesus. So just by looking at the context, keeping the commandments of God is the opposite of having the mark of the beast. If that makes sense? Because look, in verses 8 to 10, you have those that get the mark of the beast. That's verse 11 as well. But then in verse 12, you have those that keep the commandments of God. So that tells me, if I'm keeping God's commandments and I have the faith of Jesus, it's impossible for me to get the mark of the beast. Does that make sense, everyone? Oh, and that agrees perfectly with what we just saw in Exodus and Deuteronomy, that the seal of God is the name of God, which is the character of God, which is found in the law of God, in the mind. Someone say amen. Now, how many people in here tonight are New Testament Christians? How many New Covenant Christians? Raise your hand, you're a New Covenant Christian. Oh, come on, beloved, be more biblically literate than that. You're a New Covenant Christian if you're exercising faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Raise your hand. Woo! I didn't know what happened. I didn't know what. I thought maybe I was in an insurance seminar or something. I thought, whoa, okay, everybody looks a little familiar. Okay, all of you New Covenant Christians, look at Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. I don't know what happened there. That was an unusual experience. Hebrews chapter 8. But the Lord delivered us out of it. Now, Hebrews chapter 8, all of you New Covenant Christians, okay? You know, there was the old covenant, and then there's the what? New covenant. You want to know what the new covenant is? I'm going to show it to you in the Bible. That way we don't have to say, well, the new covenant is fill in the blank. I'll show you what the Bible says the new covenant is. I'm reading in verse 8. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 8. Are we all there? Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant. What kind of a covenant? A new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant. I disregarded them, says the Lord. Verse 10, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. And somebody says, oh, this is a covenant for Israel. This isn't a covenant for the church. This is a covenant for Israel. You got to keep coming to the seminar and you got to hear this, the message entitled, Who is Real is Real. Amen. There is huge misunderstandings about who Israel is, okay? Beloved, look at this. This is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. I'll give you the punchline right now. Everybody who has the faith of Abraham is a Jew. everybody who has the faith of Abraham is the son of Abraham. Jesus on one occasion said, hey, listen, if you were of your father Abraham, you would do the works of Abraham. Amen? If you do the works of Abraham, you've put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are now grafted into that vine. Someone say amen. So this covenant is for you. Here we go. Verse 10, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws. I will put my what?
Laws
in their, what's that next word?
Mind.
In their what? In their mind. Where's the mind? I'll put my laws in their forehead. That's the new covenant promise, beloved. I'll put my laws in their forehead, and I will write them on their what? Hearts. And look at this. I will be their God, and they will be my people. We're getting somewhere now. Let's go back to our study guide. The Sabbath and its uniqueness among the commandments. The Sabbath and its uniqueness among the commandments. Actually, let's go to the study guide. To understand the mark of the beast, or pardon me, to the screen, we must first understand God's what? God's seal, absolutely. God's law, God's name, and God's character are one and the same. They are, what's this word right here? Synonymous, absolutely. Now look at this, Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12. Moreover, I gave them my, what's that word? Sabbaths to be a, what is that word? A Sabbath is a sign. A Sabbath is a sign. You've got it. Between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord who what? Sanctifies them. The word sanctifies means to set aside for a holy purpose. So far, so good? This is the sign that I'm the one that sanctifies them. So the Sabbath is a sign that God alone can make us holy. Can you say amen? Jesus rested on the Sabbath in creation. Jesus rested on the Sabbath in redemption. So the Sabbath is a sign that God alone can make us holy. Not one person in this room can do one thing to make themselves one bit holier. Say amen if you believe that. We can only be holy by putting our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and by submitting ourselves to His righteousness and accepting His death and His life on our behalf. If you believe that, say amen. Okay, and so the Sabbath, as we've already discussed, is a sign of creation and redemption. Our works cannot make us holy. We must trust in and rest in God's works. What are those two words right there? For us, absolutely. Therefore, the Sabbath is a sign of trusting totally in whose righteousness? Christ's righteousness and not our own. No way. The Sabbath is a sign and seal of creation, and the Sabbath is a sign and seal of redemption. Okay, you should be able to fill a lot of this out there in your study guide, following right along. You're keeping up with me. I know you're doing a great job. Okay, so Jesus Christ, just to quickly review the Sabbath so we can be clear on this. Let's talk about the Sabbath, because some people say, oh, the Sabbath is only for the Jews. Beloved, was Adam a Jew?
No.
No, Adam predated the Jews by some 2,000 years, and Adam had the Sabbath. Eve had the Sabbath, okay? Jesus Christ, in the beginning, He created it because Jesus is the Creator. If you believe that, say amen. At Mount Sinai, it was Jesus Christ on Mount Sinai. Remember, He said before Abraham was, what? I am. I'm the God of the Old Testament, Jesus was saying. On Mount Sinai, He commanded it. In His life, He worshiped on it. Jesus kept the Sabbath. In His death, He observed it. He was crucified on Friday. He was in the tomb on the Sabbath, and He raised on what day? Sunday. You've got it. In His church, He continued it. Paul kept the Sabbath. Peter kept the Sabbath. Every single follower of Jesus, from Adam to John in the Bible, kept God's seventh-day Sabbath. So if you choose to keep God's Sabbath, you're lining up with Enoch and Isaiah and every single true follower of the true God. I'd say that's pretty good company. And most of all, you're lining up with the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Okay. He says His last day people will keep it. And we've already read that. It says His last day people will keep the commandments. We've learned that the central issue regarding the mark of the beast is the issue of what, everyone?
Worship.
So we're right there on your study guide under the mark of the beast. Right there on your study guide, you're keeping right up with me, you're doing a great job. The mark of the beast is the opposite of the seal of God. It is the what? The beast's mark is his claim to ecclesiastical authority and power. Whoo! So, the mark of the beast is the mark, let's say it together, of the beast. If that makes sense, say amen. The central issue is the issue of worship. So, the mark of the beast, then, must be the mark of the Roman church state's authority. That is a simple, childish, childlike, elementary deduction. If the mark of the beast is the mark of the beast, then it must be the mark of the Roman church state's authority. Well, let's see what we discover when we go look at history. Daniel tells us that the Antichrist power would arise and would seek to change times and what? Laws, the very laws of God. Lucius Ferraris Prompta Bibliotheca, we've looked at this one before. The Bishop of Rome is of so great authority and power that he can modify, explain, or interpret even what kind of laws? Divine laws. The Bishop of Rome can modify divine law since his power is not of man but of God, and he acts as vicegerent of God upon the earth. Now, I don't believe that. I believe God does have a representative on earth, and that representative is the Holy Spirit. Let's go on here. Question, this is from Reverend Peter Garmans, the Convert's Catechism of Catholic Doctrine. Which is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Why then do we worship on Sunday or observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Here's the answer. This is the answer of history, beloved. We observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Who transferred the solemnity? The church transferred the solemnity. What does the Roman church state claim is the sign of its authority? Because remember, the mark of the beast is the mark, what? Of the beast. And we've already seen the seal of God is his commandments. The seal of God is his commandments. Now look at Revelation chapter 13. I want to show you something absolutely fantastically amazing. Revelation chapter 13. What are the first four commandments? Let's quickly review them. Thou shalt, number one, have no other gods before me. Number two, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image. Okay? Number three, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. And the fourth commandment is remember the Sabbath. So those are the first four commandments. Those are the ones that have to do with God. The rest of the commandments have to do with how you relate to mankind. Honor your father and your mother, don't steal, don't kill, etc., etc. The first four is our vertical relationship with God. If that makes sense, say amen. All four of those commandments come into play in Revelation chapter 13. The first commandment says, you shall have no other gods before me. Look at verse 8. All who dwell on the earth will what? Worship him. That is worshiping someone other than God, so that would be a violation of the first commandment. Is that true? Yes or no? That would be a violation of the first commandment. The second commandment is not to worship an image. Not to worship a what, everyone? An image. Look at verse 15. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the what? Image of the beast should be killed. So that would be a violation of which commandment? Second commandment. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above, the earth beneath, or the waters under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. Now the third commandment is you don't take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Now look at this. Very interesting. Even the name thing comes up here. Look at verse 17. And that no one might buy or sell except he who has the mark of the beast or the number of his what? Name. So here they're actually taking the name of another entity who claims to be God's voice on earth. And then the fourth commandment is what? Remember the Sabbath day. You say, well, where's the violation of the Sabbath day here? The violation of the Sabbath day is in receiving Rome's mark of authority. Rome's, what did I say? Mark of authority. Because remember, let's review, the mark of the beast is the mark of the beast. If that makes sense, say amen. So we know who the beast is. Now let's ask them the question, what's your mark? Let's ask them. Let's ask them, what's your mark? What do they claim is their mark? Catholic Record, September 1, 1923. The church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance is what? Proof of that fact. The church is above the Bible. We change the day. We change the day. And this proves that we are the true church. Look at this one. From C.F. Thomas, a letter dated October 20th, 1895. Of course the church claims the change was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in what kind of matters? Oh, isn't that very interesting? So let's ask them, hey, what's the mark of your authority? I'll tell you what the mark of our authority is, they say. We change the biblical day of worship. That is our mark. Wow, isn't that interesting? We've looked at the first commandment. We've looked at the second commandment. We've looked at the third commandment. The fourth commandment is remember the Sabbath day, which is a sign that God is creator and God is what? Redeemer. How many people in this room believe that Jesus Christ is the creator? How many people in this room believe that Jesus Christ is the sole redeemer? Okay, there's a sign, there is a symbol and a sign in the Bible that shows that you're a worshiper of Jesus Christ as Creator and Redeemer. Do you know what that sign is? It's the Sabbath. That's exactly right. It's the Sabbath. That, think of it this way. A Buddhist could keep many of the commandments. A Buddhist could abstain from killing. Is that true? Yes or no? Does that make him a Christian? A Muslim could abstain from stealing. Does that make him a Christian? Which is the commandment that tells you this is the God that you're worshiping? It's the Sabbath commandment, because the Sabbath commandment says that God created in how many days? 6 days, and rested on the what day? The seventh day. So when you keep the Sabbath, you're worshiping the Creator God, the Redeemer God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The devil knows that that is the sign between God as Creator, God as Redeemer, and His people. And so he wants to cut that sign off, and he supplants his own sign. His own mark. What is that mark? Of course, the church claims that the chains was her act. And the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical. That word means church power and authority in religious matters. Now look at this one. Priest Thomas Enright. This is president of Redemptorist College. He said, prove to me from the Bible. Prove to me from the what? Prove to me from the Bible alone that I am bound to keep what? Sunday holy. There is no such law in the Bible. It is a law of the church. What's the next word? Alone. The Bible says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The church says, whew, is that serious language, yes or no? That's hugely serious. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep holy the first day of the week. And lo, look at this. The entire civilized world bows down in reverent obedience to the command of Jesus Christ. What does it say? To the command of who? Who? The Roman Church? Beloved, are you beginning to see the significance of this? Yes or no? Let's go to our study guide. Absolutely incredible. So we're down there on more than just a day. Okay? Because someone's bound to say, oh, it's just a day. Listen, if it was just a day, God wouldn't have written it with his own finger on tables of stone and put it in the ark. Someone say amen. Okay, look at this. This issue is about more than just a day. Imagine Adam saying, it was just an apple. God's word is important, amen? Oh, it was just an apple. I guess it wasn't just an apple, was it? It is about, notice this, underline, biblical fidelity and faithfulness to who? Jesus Christ. In short, the issue could be boiled down to the following sentence. Who are you taking orders from? The Roman church state or from Jesus Christ? This is an issue of loyalty and authority. It is an issue of the commands of God versus the traditions of man. The Sabbath is a sign of Christ's creation and redemption. Sunday is a sign of the church's authority and man's convenience. What will you choose? Now someone says, whoa, put the brakes on, Pastor Ashrick. Are you saying that my aunt Bertha, who went all of her life to the humble little Baptist church there in Tuscaloosa, are you saying she had the mark of the beast? Did I say that? No. I never said that. Remember, this has to be enforced because it's they cause to worship. They cause to worship. They cause to worship. Does anybody make you go to church on Sunday?
No.
So we're not yet at the mark of the beast issue. The mark of the beast is not being enforced today. Someone say amen.
Amen.
It's not being enforced today. But what I'm telling you is that there is going to come a day when worship will be enforced. Worship will be what?
Enforced.
And you think, no, impossible. Beloved, Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3, there was Shadrach, say it with me, Meshach and Abednego, and there was a great big tall image. And Nebuchadnezzar said, everyone bow down and worship the image or you'll be thrown into the fiery furnace. In other words, worship or else. And everyone bows down, but here's Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, and they said, we cannot worship this image because we have to be faithful to the commandments of our God.
Amen.
And not just to the commandments of our God, but to God. And everybody bows down all around them. And there they stood, absolutely erect. Can someone say amen?
Pow!
powerful. So at the end of time, we see this same thing. There's going to be an image, and we're going to be told, worship, except this time it's not going to be primarily a test of the first commandment or the second commandment. It's going to be a test of the fourth commandment. And you're saying, wait a minute. Are you saying that we're going to be forced to dishonor the Sabbath? Are you saying we're going to be forced to dishonor the sign of Jesus Christ as Redeemer and Creator and worship on the papal day as an act of forced, compulsive worship? Are you saying that? That's exactly what I'm saying. St. Catherine Catholic Church Sentinel, May 21st, 1995. Hey, listen, this is the newsletter from a Catholic church, not from my church. This is not from my church. Perhaps the boldest thing, the most revolutionary change the church ever did happened in the first century. The holy day, the Sabbath, was changed from what? Saturday to what? Sunday. Look at this. Not my church. Not from any directions noted in the what? Scriptures. But from the church's sense of its own power. People who think that the scriptures should be the sole authority. How many people believe that the scriptures should be the sole authority? Now, I believe that too. I want you to see what the Catholic priest says. Okay? I want to see what, this is not a member of my church. I want you to see what the Catholic priest says. The Catholic priest says, people who think that scripture should be the sole authority should logically become Seventh-day Adventists. Well, what is a Seventh-day Adventist? Never heard of that before. And keep what? Saturday holy. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that amazing? If you want to stand on what the Bible says and not what tradition says, not what the church says, not what man says, the priest says, then you need to do something. Absolutely amazing. Now look, you think that's amazing? Look at this. Dr. E.T. Hiscox, this guy wrote the Baptist manual. This guy's a Baptist. And he's not just a Baptist, he was the Baptist, one of them. Look at this. This is amazing. He says, to me it seems amazing, that's what this word means, unaccountable, that Jesus, during 3 years' discussion with his disciples, often conversing with them on the Sabbath question, discussing it in some of its various aspects, freeing it from its false Jewish traditional glosses, never alluded to any transference of the day. Also, that during the 40 days of his resurrection life, no such thing was intimated. He never mentioned anything about it. Nor, so far as we know, did the Spirit, which was given to bring to their remembrance all things whatsoever he had said unto them, deal with this question. Nor did the inspired apostles in preaching the gospel. He's saying, hey, where did this thing come from, says Mr. Hiscox, author of the Baptist Manual. Founding churches, counseling and instructing those founded, discuss or approach the subject. Of course, he says, I quite well know that Sunday did come to use in early Christian history as a religious day, as we learn from the church fathers and other sources. And notice this. But what a pity that it comes branded with the mark of what? Paganism. Because it's Sunday. The day that the Romans worshipped the sun. We'll talk more about that in a future night. And christened with the name of the sun god, then adopted and sanctified by the what? Papal apostasy. In other words, the church just took it from the Romans. The church took it from the Romans and bequeathed as a sacred legacy to what? Protestantism. Again, not a member of my church. Look at this. The Catholic Mirror, December 23rd, 1893. Reason and sense demand the acceptance of one or the other of these alternatives. Either Protestantism and the keeping of what? Saturday, or Catholicity and the keeping holy of what? Sunday. And notice what he says next. He says compromise is impossible. He says, hey, listen, if you really are serious about standing on what the Bible says, then you got to stand on what all of the Bible says, because the Bible's not a salad bar. Someone say amen. You don't go say, well, you know, I like the tomatoes, but I'm not a mushroom guy. And I like the green peppers, but, oh, I can't stand those beets. No. You get it all. You get what? Not just the parts that you like. You get the whole word. Someone say amen. Now, if you want to pick and choose, you can pick and choose. But don't say that everything you believe comes from the Bible. Does that make sense, everyone? Okay? So let's wrap this up. Let's wrap this up. In fact, I'll come back to that tomorrow night. Our presentation tomorrow night. Yeah, I know. You saw that, didn't you?
Yeah.
You're like, ah! Our presentation tomorrow night is entitled The United States' Amazing Role in Bible Prophecy. Now, I want to be crystal clear about what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. Number one, if you keep God's commands, you cannot get the mark of the beast. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. Now, question, do we keep God's commandments in order to be saved or because we are saved? Because we are saved. By the way, bring this back tomorrow night. You've got to come back tomorrow night. You only got the first half. And plus, you have to learn what 666 is. Second thing I'm saying, follow this. Second thing is this. There's going to be forced worship. You say, impossible. I say, come back tomorrow night and I'll show you just how possible it is. Are we all clear on that, everyone? But let me tell you what I'm not saying. I am not saying that the good person who loves the Lord Jesus Christ with all of her heart, all of his heart, all of their soul, who happens to go to church on Sunday, I am not saying that that person has the mark of the beast. Am I crystal clear? Am I crystal clear? I don't want anyone going out here saying, oh, that guy over there at the Macedonian Cultural Center, he said all Sunday worshipers had the mark of the beast. Did I say that tonight? Didn't say it, wouldn't say it. But let me tell you what I am saying. I'm saying that there is going to come a time when this issue is going to be enforced. Is going to be what, everyone? Enforced. And God has his sign of creation. God has his sign of redemption. It's the Sabbath. It's based on the scriptures. It's not more important than the other commandments. Someone say amen. But it's the commandment that's been forgotten. That's why it begins with the word remember. Amen? It is going to happen. And we will have to make a stand for the Lord or against the Lord. Now, as for me and my house, I want to stand for the Lord. Amen? See, beloved, the mark of the beast is the mark of the beast. And the seal of God is God's holy name, God's holy law, God's Holy Spirit put into the lives of humble, faithful believers who say, Jesus, whatever you say, I'll do it. I don't care if it's convenient. I don't care if it goes against my tradition. I don't care if it's not what I believed before. But if it's in the Bible, I'm going to obey it. Amen. Someone say amen.
Amen.
Now, beloved, here's what we're going to do. I got ushers that are going to stand up and give you a decision card because I don't want to preach a message like this and not give you an opportunity to make a decision. To make a what, everyone?
Decision.
To make a decision. And you might be thinking to yourself, wait a minute, how is this possible? How could this possibly happen? I need those ushers to be moving like this. We need to pretend like we're in a race. Boom, those ushers are moving just like this. Okay, it's like boom, 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 boom. Now you're saying, how could this possibly happen? Tomorrow night, we're going to be looking at the United States' amazing role in Bible prophecy. While they're passing this out, open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 15. Thank you. Matthew chapter 15. Look at this. Look at verse 7. Verse 7. Matthew chapter 15, verse 7. Jesus, these aren't the words of David, so don't say David doesn't understand grace. These are the words of Jesus. Did Jesus understand grace? Beloved, did Jesus understand grace?
Yes.
Jesus said, hypocrites, actors, well did Isaiah prophesy about you saying, these people draw near to me with their what? You know what that means? It means they talk the what? They talk the talk. They draw near to me with their mouths and they honor me with their lips. But what's far from him? Their heart is far from him. Then look at verse 9. And in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the what? The commandments of men. You see, in the days of Jesus, they had set aside the commands of God for the traditions and the commands of men. And I'm telling you, the devil, he's not inventive. He's not creative. That's what he did in the days of Jesus. That's what he's going to do at the end of time. He's going to supplant the teachings and the doctrines of God with the traditions and the commandments of men. If that makes sense, say amen.